You're listening to Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. We're here on the unceded traditional territory of the Salish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. This is Bernadine Fox, here with my co-host for the week, Don Wright, bringing you Both Sides Now. Welcome to our show. I'm Bernadine Fox.
And I'm co-host Don Wright.
And today on Both Sides Now, we're sitting down with Teresa Morton, who is the coordinator of My Artist Corner, more commonly known as MAC. MAC is a Burnaby-based art program for adults living with mental health issues. So, Teresa, welcome.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
We're glad to have you, actually. Can you give us a little bit more information on what My Artist Corner is? I think it's been around for about 12 years.
Yeah. And so as an art program, we have classes and we do things like go to the art gallery and do shows and things like that. And as an art program for artists living with mental health issues, we're very careful to be accommodating to people's situations. Mm-hmm. And we work really hard to have a safe, welcoming environment.
And in that environment, they take classes and everything, but I think you also have studios. Do you still have studios?
We have what we call open studio. We share the space with the Burnaby Mental Health Clubhouse. Oh. So every day we have to get out all our equipment. And at the end of the day, we have to clean up and put everything back again. Wow. So we do have open studio where people can work on their own projects. It's very popular.
And what kind of work do they do there? Is it like mixed media or oil?
We do mixed media and acrylics, watercolors, and all sorts of drawing media.
And the classes that you do, are those or do they... Are the classes about those mediums, or are they other
yes.
kinds of classes?
We have art history classes as mm-hmm. well as technique classes. And we have instructors come in from the community. And so there will be, each month, there will be some acrylic classes, some watercolor classes, and some mixed media.
And the membership. You said that this is folks who are living with mental health issues.
Yes. So the three situations that we have are anxiety disorders ranging from mild to debilitating, mm-hmm. Mood disorders such as depression or bipolar disorder, and illnesses related to schizophrenia. Mm-hmm. So folks will come to MAC having experienced a range of symptoms. Sometimes mm-hmm. there are physical disabilities as well mm-hmm. as mental health issues. And every person's situation is understandably unique.
Do you screen people? Do you have an intake? How do you manage that?
Well, we ask that people are well enough that they would be able to concentrate for 5 or 10 minutes at a time mm-hmm. so that they are able to focus. We ask that people be able to clean up after themselves and take care of the equipment. And as being part of the safe and welcoming environment, we want people to be comfortable with being respectful and polite. Mm-hmm. So we do have a process for intake. people connect with me to start with, and then the program is open to people living in Burnaby and New Westminster. Mm-hmm. And then the next step is to become a member of one of the mental health clubhouses, either in New Westminster or in Burnaby. And then we have an orientation session, which we call Actively Artistic, which happens twice a month. Mm-hmm. And then the people are ready to come and have a free trial day to see if MAC suits them.
So, naive person here, what does Clubhouse mean? What is that? It seems to be a something that...
Yes. Each city has one or more mental health clubhouses. Mm. And they're places where you can get support for with things like employment, or socializing, or building social skills, or just hanging out and working toward some sort of wellness recovery plan.
So then is MAC sort of an extension of the clubhouse, or is this a cooperation agreement that you've...
Yes, we have a cooperation agreement with the clubhouse.
Yeah, but, is there a membership fee, or how is it supported?
The answer is yes, there's a membership fee. Each person pays $20 each month.
Oh, okay.
And that covers about half the costs of the materials and equipment. Mm. The other half we have from our fundraising and grants and things like that.
So you have exhibitions?
Yes, we do.
And
we have two exhibitions each year. One is held at Shadbolt Center for the Arts, which is in Burnaby's Deer Lake Park.
Yes.
And we have that on a Saturday. This year, it's going to be October 3rd. We also have an exhibition coming up at Braid Street Studios, which is 100 Braid Street in New Westminster. And that will be Saturday, May 2nd. And we've chosen the theme for that one, and the theme is Things with Wings.
I love that. Mm, yeah. And so in these exhibitions, folks who are members of MAC are able to submit work to participate. Is there a jury portion of that, or is it just...
No.
Okay.
One of the things that we work with at MAC is an assumption that all art is of equal value. Mm-hmm. And that allows people to use art as a way to express themselves and a way to build calmness and focus.
Mm-hmm.
So for our shows, each person decides what they want to exhibit.
Okay, cool. And that's October 3rd at the Shadbolt and May 2nd at 100 Braid Street Studios.
Yes.
I've never been to Braid Street.
It's a wonderful spot.
Mm-hmm.
It has a beautiful exhibition space, and there's a lot of artist studios. It is now the largest artist studio outside of Vancouver in the Lower Mainland.
That's pretty cool. Mm. I did not know that. And also, there was something on the brochure that I saw that there was a 30-minute volunteer time. Is that a part of the membership as well?
Yes, it is. It's a peer-led program, so a lot of the work to keep it going is done by volunteers, either mm-hmm. MAC members or people who think it's a great program and volunteer with us over the years.
Right. So the 30 minutes, is that what is the volunteer time that they're doing, though? What does that encompass?
It can be as simple as making sure that all the dishes are washed at the end of the day. It can be helping people to write their CVs and artist statements. It can be keeping track of the money that comes in as memberships. And also, around the time of our shows, there's quite a bit of work that needs to be done to get the show ready.
Right.
So members volunteer before, during, and after the shows.
Right. Okay.
You mentioned storing supplies and... keeping track and let maybe making sure you've got enough of whatever needed.
Yes. And we have about 1,000 hours of volunteer time every year.
That you need to fill. Is that what you mean? Or that people offer?
That people offer.
Okay. Okay. So the orientation sessions, what does that mean? Would people come? How many people are there? I'm just trying to get people some idea of what that looks like so that... the idea of coming might not be so frightening for some people who have difficulties in groups.
Yes. at the orientation sessions, there's maybe five or six people who get together to do some kind of art project, mm-hmm. small art project that can be done in an hour or an hour and a half. And it's led by a MAC member. Mm-hmm. And people get a chance to see the space and get an idea for what would be happening there on a MAC day.
So the orientation session is really just sort of doing what normally happens
yes.
in there, but in a much more structured way, perhaps.
Yes.
Okay.
Simplified.
And they happen once a month or twice?
Twice a month.
Twice a month. And are there enough people coming who want to be members of MAC that they fill that type of schedule of 2 a month?
Yes, there are.
How many members does MAC have?
We have 25 active members.
Okay, that's cool. where is the clubhouse? This is where all of this happens.
The clubhouse is at Edmonds and Canada Way. So the actual address is 7355 Canada Way, room 109.
And if somebody wants to come to MAC, should they be showing up there or should they be calling you ahead of time and arranging? Or?
They can call me ahead of time.
Okay.
My number is 778-855-1704.
And do you have a website?
Yes, it's myartistscorner.ca.
Myartistscorner, all one word, .ca.
Yeah.
Okay. Teresa, thank you for coming in and sharing this important information about My Artist Corner with us. Next, we'll be chatting with Penny Goldsmith about an interesting forum that she and others put on to talk about the importance of art and mental health and the need for funding.
Don't wish it away. Look at it like it's forever. Between you and me, I could honestly say that things can only get better. Before you and me run to the place in our hearts where we hide. And I guess that's why they call it the blues. Time on my hands, could be time spent with you. Laughing like children. Space, picture my face in your hands. Live for each second without hesitation, and never forget I'm your man. Wait on me, girl. Cry in the night if it helps.
Join us every Monday from 2:30 to 4 p.m. for She Boom. Open your ears to the sound of the latest and greatest women in music. Our show focuses entirely on female artists, from a local to global perspective. Every Monday from 2:30 to 4 p.m., tune in to She Boom on CFRO 100.5 FM Co-op Radio.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox.
And I'm co-host Don Wright.
And we've asked Teresa to stay with us as we sit down with Penny Goldsmith from the Highs and Lows Choir. Hi, Penny.
Hi.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Penny's a longtime anti-poverty activist who was instrumental in organizing a dialogue entitled Community Conversations in November of late last year about the importance of art in our mental health. And Teresa has agreed to hang out with us and continue chatting about this because Teresa was there, as well as I was, and our co-host here, Don Wright, was that day. So there's an interesting story, Penny, about how Community Conversations came about, and I was hoping that you could tell us a little bit about how that happened.
Well, Highs and Lows has been around since 1993. It's a mental health choir. And for many years, they received funding from the Community Initiative Fund of Vancouver Coastal Health. Mm-hmm. And then in 2016, along with a lot of other mental health and arts organizations, their funding got cut.
Yes.
And what that meant was this choir that was, you know, doing really well and was really supportive of people with mental health issues for them to come and sing, suddenly had no money left.
Right.
At that point, Earl Peach, who's the conductor.
Yay, Earl Peach.
got in touch with me and asked me if I would be willing to be on this new board of directors that they set up because they realized they were going to have to find funding elsewhere. Mm-hmm. I agreed to do that. And we started on sort of a route of, you know, trying to keep ourselves going, trying to keep ourselves alive. It was very clear to me right away that it's a very important choir. Mm-hmm. I mean, I had been in another couple of choirs at the same time, and this one was very different. I mean, this one was a choir where the support that people, you know, give each other is not just about singing songs together. It's also about being together. It's about people pay attention to each other. If someone doesn't turn up for a few weeks, you know, people get in touch. And it shouldn't go.
No.
And what happened was that I started being aware of the fact that it wasn't just Highs and Lows that have had their funding cut. Other mental arts and mental health organizations had too.
Yes.
And so I started talking, you know, with them. I mean, for many years I organized, I was involved with an organization called PovNet, which was an online resource for anti-poverty advocates. So I kind of have been in that kind of space where I was used to talking to a lot of different organizations about the work that they did. And it became clear that we needed to start talking to each other.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've talked to Highs and Lows Choir, and people were interested in sort of following up on this, not just for their own choir, but also for the whole arts and mental health community. And then the NDP got into power, and they created this new ministry called the Ministry of Mental Health and Addictions.
Right.
And I thought to myself, well, we have this mental health ministry, we have this mental health choir, they should have a relationship with each other.
Yeah.
So I wrote to Judy Darcy and said, you know, give us some money, please. And they did. So last year, they gave us some money for the Highs and Lows Choir and an additional $5,000, $4,000 to host this Community Conversations about Arts and Mental Health. And so that's how it all started.
Great.
And so you created an organizing committee, which
yes.
you did very well.
We wanted to involve people from different arts and mental health fields, not just singing, although singing is very important.
So
is everything else. I mean, the work that you were talking about, you know, Teresa. That I mean, it's all part of the package of giving people, empowering people, you know, to feel sort of they have some kind of their confidence and important.
Mm-hmm.
And the organizing committee was it was you, Bernadine.
Yes, fair disclosure, I was on that organizing committee.
And me and Earl Peach from the choir, and Tara Palacombe was also in the choir, the Art Studios, Anne Webern, and Sandra Yun McKay, who's an artist and author, and Carnegie was involved as well.
Right.
And we had a facilitator. Her name was Amanda Fenton. Mm-hmm. And because we had this grant, we were able to actually, you know, pay for a facilitator. Mm-hmm. And she was great. She was really very key. And she wasn't just a question of being there for the day. She really cared about the issue. She came to a lot of our organizing meetings. She had ideas. She suggested things. And we all went, that's not going to work. And so she went away and thought about it and came back with, you know, different ideas. And it made the day work, I think, yes. to have that outside kind of voice, you know.
So we got this group of people together, we designed a day, and the day of, we opened it up, and Sandra did the actual opening, and I was hoping you could talk a little bit about what Sandra said at the morning. It doesn't have to be absolutely spot on.
Well, she just talked about her own experience as an artist and mental health. Funny the words, you know. I mean, mental health, mental illness, I don't like the word consumer, but it's one that we sort of use because it's, you know... It says something, I suppose. But she's somebody who has had experience as somebody who's someone with mental health issues, mm-hmm. And as an artist. And mm-hmm. she talked about, she gave a kind of a 5-minute TED talk at the beginning to start us off for the day, which was, we weren't looking for panels. We weren't looking for, you know, sort of experts. Well, we were looking for experts, but we were the experts.
Yes.
And that's kind of was the important thing about the day. And that's how it was all structured. It was structured so that everyone who was there was able to be involved right from the get-go.
Right.
And I think that worked, Teresa?
Yes, it worked very well.
Yeah, I think it did. We weren't sure, you know. I mean, and people who are more used to regular events were sort of wanted more of an agenda initially. But Amanda was really, she was really pushing for this, and she was right. Mm-hmm. I mean, it worked.
So in the morning of this dialogue,
yes,
one of the things that you had folks do is break into groups and to talk about their experience of art and mental health and some of the positive things that had come out of that. And I was hoping that maybe you could talk about a few of them that came up that day.
Well, the positive impact of the arts and mental health, some of the issues that came out of that discussion in the morning was support and creating an accessible and safe space, which is what you were talking about earlier, Teresa, and building relations in the community. Mm-hmm. Connecting with rural communities outside the Lower Mainland was something that came up that was, you know, that people thought was important because often, you know, the focus is on the Lower Mainland and there's things going on all over the province.
Yeah.
Belonging to a group and gaining insight into traumatic experiences and healing and fostering self-esteem. Mm-hmm. It's funny because we did an evaluation at the choir the last couple of days because we're putting a grant application in, and we all had to fill out this evaluation form. And one of the questions was, you know, sort of what is good about coming and singing.
Right.
And I sort of filled it out, and I said, actually, it gives me more confidence in myself, you know, to be doing this.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that came across really clearly. So in the morning we talked about those issues, and we, you know, and Amanda gathered them all together for us. And in the afternoon, we created our own agenda, and this was something that is not always an easy thing to do. I've been at various meetings where this has happened, where it's been a complete, you know, fiasco, and so I kind of held my breath and trusted Amanda. And it was great because what was really clear from the morning was that people really wanted to talk to each other. They really wanted to continue, you know, sort of this discussion. And so...
discussion about what?
About arts
the
and mental
positive
health.
Impact.
No, about what to do next.
Oh, okay.
This was
this
was a proactive meeting. This wasn't like one of those, you know, sort of we're going to meet and then we're going to, you know, not do anything else.
Right.
So it was like, okay, where do we go? And so people set up meeting spaces to talk about things that they wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a group to talk about creating a document, pulling together resources about the importance of arts and mental health, that we can use for funders, that we can all use for funders.
Right.
So rather than competing, well, you know, we're always competing with each other, of course, but to be able to say, you know, these are some examples of things that could work. So this is ongoing.
So let me just stop you there with the document so that I understand and maybe our listeners understand. So this document would be something that where you're compiling information like from sources that you can share and everybody can use those same things.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah. And also, you know, paragraphs. I mean, you know, that we can sort of, you know, steal from each other and use and examples and because we all do the same grant applications and why should we reinvent the wheel? That's one thing. There's a group that's doing podcasts. They've started doing them. They've got 3 of them on the go now.
Cool.
You know, talking about again arts and mental health issues. Well, there are other things. We don't have a website of our own, excuse me, at this point, but we're going to create a page on the Highs and Lows website where people can find all the resources from this event. So that's, you know, that's a starting point. I mean, mm-hmm. We may not get any more money, you mm-hmm. know, and we're going to need a bit of money to sort of do some of this stuff. So, but we're very lucky. We are on Vancouver Community Network, the Freenet.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, we have access to all of those resources for, you know, and their support from that organization,
right.
which I've sort of.
Okay, so I'm just going to stop here. And for those who may have just joined us, we've been chatting with Penny Goldsmith and Teresa Morton about Community Conversations, a dialogue which Penny organized to talk about the importance of art in mental health. And when we come back, I am going to ask Penny some more about where this dialogue is going. So stay put, we'll be right back.
Kulch is thrilled to present the Vancouver premiere of Ronnie Burkett's Forget Me Not, February 4th to March 1st. Forget Me Not will run for 4 weeks in a secret location, revealed to the audience members before the show. Welcome to the new now, a time when written language has been suppressed and forgotten, and hand-drawn love letters have become a powerful act of defiance. Unlike anything previously experienced, this mysterious and thrilling new production offers each audience member the rare opportunity to hold a one-of-a-kind Ronnie Burkett hand puppet, becoming a puppet chorus. The audience both witnesses and propels the story as it unfolds, an inspiring theatrical love letter for increasingly uncivilized times. For more information, visit tickets.thekulch.com.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox here with my co-host, Don Wright, and we're chatting with Teresa Morton from MAC and Penny Goldsmith from the Highs and Lows Choir about community conversations and why art is important in mental health. So one of the things that I know we did that day was we talked a lot about why art is important in mental health. What do we get out of it? And I just want to go back to the show that we just had called Drawbridge with an author whose name is Joan Boxall, who wrote a story about her brother, Stephen Corcoran, who had schizophrenia. And she talked about how taking him to the art studio and then to Basic Inquiry in the process of doing artwork and finishing the artwork actually calmed him down and made him gave him a sense of confidence that he didn't have before. And I just wanted to put that out there to you folks and talk about a little bit about what you guys know about how art impacts on folks who participate in it.
We often find that people are able to focus longer. They have a better sense of calmness. They gain confidence. Mm-hmm. And participating in the art programs allows people to reduce isolation and to develop a sense of hope, mm-hmm, that wellness is possible. And they develop meaningful connections, as Penny was saying, between the people that participate in the program.
Right.
So you'll see things like people saying, "MAC is where I'm appreciated and have value as my realist self."
Mm. Wow. Yeah. My realist self. I like that.
Yeah.
And it is true when folks have mental health issues that they often have to pretend out in the world to be something that they're not. So
yes.
Yeah. So I know that we talked a lot about that on that afternoon, in the afternoon. What kinds of things came up on those pieces of paper?
Well, I think little stickies. Yes. I think a lot of those kind of the same issues came up, that the healing was a very big one, you know, mm-hmm, that it was that it was really important for people to be able to go somewhere where they could feel like they were themselves, as right. you said, Teresa. I think that's why people were so excited at the event. I mean, you know, people stayed. I mean, mm-hmm. people didn't leave at lunchtime, you know,
yes.
even after lunch.
Yes.
And I think that's because they wanted to keep talking about this because they realized they were talking to people who, you know, that we all could have worked, you know, caring about this issue and trying to figure out a way to deal with the issues and obstacles that were, you know,
right.
were surfacing. So.
So let's talk about some of those mm-hmm. obstacles. I noticed that one of the things that you did in the... in the report mm-hmm. was this quote, freedom of expression is critical to those with mental illness and that our culture, by and large, doesn't facilitate this.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the obstacles in society generally is the lack of ability for people to express really what are the challenges they have around mental health issues. And so art does provide some of that. But there are real obstacles to providing programming like Teresa's My Artist Corner.
Yep.
And so part of that is a lack of funding, which you mentioned before. And it says here, the never-ending stress of fundraising.
Oh, God,
I know.
Yes.
It's just agonizing, isn't it?
It is, and it's so frustrating because we shouldn't have to do that. I mean, it's so obvious.
Right.
And that's one of the
right.
things that we want to create with the work that we're going to continue to be doing. It's like, look, I mean, it's really clear that this is important. Arts and mental health is important. I mean, and we shouldn't have to do these kind of nickel and dimes things, you know?
Right.
So let's just, you know, surmise or just spend some time wondering why it is that arts are not given their full due. What happens in there? I mean, we see it in the schools as well, is that the first thing to go is the mm-hmm. art program.
It's like candy or something like that. It's not seen as an integral part of people's lives and who they are. And I think that's what we need to change.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we need to sort of figure out, you know, how to make it really, really clear
mm-hmm.
that is a very important part of what makes art work. I mean, we know it, you know, when you're sort of working in it.
Mm-hmm.
But how do we make it clear that it is as important to fund, MAC or, you know, highs and lows, and much cheaper.
Yes.
Than to sort of have someone on a psych board.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
I mean, it's obvious.
I know, it is. It's clearly obvious.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure, like, when you say that, I think of all the research projects or programs that I know have happened in the UK and in the States and even here in Vancouver that have supported that very thing, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That there's less pain, they're more mm-hmm. social, they are able to function more, they live longer, their blood pressure goes down, all of that stuff. And yet here we are still having to make people understand that art is important. So
yeah,
I think there's a lot of social stigma that the only valuable art is something that's gallery worthy.
Mm.
But art is an expression of one's personal life. It doesn't have to look like a Gauguin painting, you know? And I think that's what we have to do is realize that it's the expression that's important, not some kind of product that has market value.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's the process that heals.
Yes.
That's really true. And redefine what, you know, market value is. I mean, that's
right.
one of the things with funders is that they're very narrow definitions of
yeah.
what is art, you know, and I think we need to expand that. And it does happen. I mean, there are,
sure.
you know, experimental kind of theater things and the things that go on in the city, you know, but mostly they cost like a lot of money to go to, you know. I mean, it's, you know, and it's it needs to be accessible. It needs to be accessible to audiences as well as to,
right.
you know, to people.
Well, I think the outcome measures, like, you know, the blood pressure dropping and,
mm-hmm.
and there's so many positive effects that just go into your grant applications to
mm-hmm.
look, see what it does.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Exactly.
Yeah. Do you think we're having a problem around it because there is this thing called art therapy that happens? People pay money to go see an art therapist, and the idea that people who are making art, and say in an expressive arts group or at My Artist Corner or at Highs and Lows, where there isn't a therapist there to somehow sanction the fact that it's healing. Is that something we're dealing with here?
I don't know. I don't know anything about art therapy. Officially. I mean, I seriously don't. I understand that, but I'm just wondering
whether or not that's part of it, in that there is this thing called art therapy, and there are art therapists, and they go to school, and they have a degree in it, or a diploma, or whatever, and perhaps the idea that art can just be healing on its own without that professional sitting in the room somehow is problematic for people. Well, what do you think, Teresa? Sorry.
I think that the peer-led art programs are an additional strength, and that the art therapy process is gradually learning about the importance of having a peer-led component to it. Mm-hmm. So I think we are making progress.
Right.
I almost went into art therapy way back when, and there were really two distinct disciplines when it comes to art therapy. One is where the therapist reads into your work, and they're looking for symbols, you know, Jungian art therapy and all that stuff. Whereas the other discipline, it asks the artist to interpret what they've just done. So you put something on paper, and then instead of sitting there, you know, with your brilliant knowledge, being able to interpret what that person just did, you say, well, tell me about that. Tell me about the colors you use. What does the shape mean to you? Or there's a lot of energy in this part of the work. What's going on there? So you really get the artist to talk about what they've done rather than imposing your interpretation. And I think that that's a much better approach. And I think it's a lot more effective one as well.
There is another approach. So you've talked about too. The other approach is just letting people make art and not discussing it at all. Right. And I think that is as healing, and sometimes allows the artist to have more expression if they don't feel like they have to then turn around and talk about what they put in it as well. I don't know.
Yeah. I think what we need to do is teach funders that.
Yes.
Because I think that the tendency to want to go for something, you know, for art therapy, more oriented stuff with funders is there. And I think that what we need to do is educate funders to say exactly that what is, you know, what is important with art and mental health is exactly that, is that, you know, people just do it. People just come and sing. People just come and make art. You know, it's as simple as that.
I know, I get it. But I also wonder whether or not that's part of the problem with funding, is that people are freaked out that you're calling something maybe is healing when you don't have that professional in the room, that somehow they're going to be somehow responsible for healing that isn't sanctioned by a professional.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know either. I just wondered.
I think that there is a little bit of that. Mm-hmm. And as I said before, the peer component, the support that people get from one another, the support that comes from understanding that people have had similar experiences, their traumas are maybe related in some way to what you've experienced. I think those things make it such a so much more stronger experience.
I agree.
I think in most grants, they're looking for outcome measures, you know, something tangible outcome. But, you know, how do you measure happiness or self-esteem that comes out of art making?
There's no widgets involved, for sure.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there's no data that can be pumped out.
But I think that what was really clear out of the event that happened at the end of November was that, first of all, that people were comfortable and really solid on the idea that decisions had to be made by all of us in the room.
Yes.
And that's why they were there, and that's why they stayed. And that's why they want to continue talking to each other, and that's what we're figuring out what to do next.
So where is it going next? Well, what's happening? There's a podcast. I know you did this report, which is a great report. Thank you.
There's three podcasts that are in the works right now.
And where do people find those?
Well, what we're doing at the moment is we're creating a page on the Highs and Lows site that's specifically for all this stuff. And so you'll be able to, once we've got it up and running, I've got to go talk to Vancouver Community Network this week, Nick's, then people will be able to find all of this there.
Okay.
And the Highs and Lows website is highsandlowschoir.ca.
And that's all written out. So Highs and Lows Choir, all one word, and is written out. It's not enough.
Yeah. No, because
that's it. Yeah, I know.
Yeah. And we also have an email address we didn't want to start an organization. It was quite clear people did not want to start another organization out of the event. They wanted to be able to network better because we hadn't been doing that, you know, because everyone was just, you know, tearing out their hair, keeping themselves alive.
Right.
And so this is the start of that as well. So we've got an email list which is pending as well. And if people want to get hold of us in the meantime, they can do that by emailing artsandmentalhealth@gmail.com.
So artsandmentalhealth is all one word, at gmail.com.
Yeah.
And just so people know, we will make all of this available on our resource page under Community Conversations so that people will be able to find it. You're also talking about arranging a meeting with the Minister of Mental Health and Addiction.
Well,
is that something that's sort of in the works?
It was on the list. It's hard to do.
Right.
And, you know, I don't know if we'll get any more money from them next year because their money is not nearly, they don't have nearly as much money this year as they had last year. So
does that mean we're all mentally better?
Yeah, absolutely. So I don't know whether we will have any more money from them or not. But we definitely have started something, and I think it's really important that we keep it going. And that's sort of what we will.
Yeah.
It will. It's not going to go away.
So the other thing that sort of came out of this is to set up a consortium of mental health and arts organizations. Is that the networking thing that you were talking about?
Yeah.
So that everybody could find each other and maybe collaborate on certain things. And
well, in the afternoon, what happened was people broke up into groups to talk about specific things. And I don't know whether they shared email addresses with each other, but we can certainly facilitate them doing that. You know,
okay.
So people can talk to each other, keep going to each other.
We've been chatting with Teresa Morton from My Artist Corner, a peer-run art program for mental health consumers that runs out of Burnaby, and with Penny Goldsmith, who, through the Highs and Lows Choir, organized a community-based program looking at creating resources for art-based programs to use for obtaining funding and a means of networking different groups that use art in mental health. Information about both of these programs can be found on our resource page. We'll be right back.
Hey, did you know Red Eye has a podcast? You can tune in to Red Eye every Saturday morning from 10 a.m. to noon, and now you can catch our interviews anytime. Look for the Red Eye podcast on iTunes, TuneIn Radio, or a host of other podcast apps. Or you can check out our latest episode right on our website, cooperadio.org/redeye.
Shadows on my wall. All night, hearing voices telling me that I should get some sleep because tomorrow might be good for something. Hold on, feeling like I'm headed for a breakdown, and I don't know. You're gonna think of me and how I used to be me, and talking to myself in public and dodging glances on the train. And I know they've all been talking about me. I can hear them whisper, and it makes me think there must be something wrong with me. Out of all the hours thinking, somehow I've lost my mind. But I'm not crazy, I'm just a little unwell. I know right now you can't tell, but stay a while and maybe then you'll see a different side of me. I'm not crazy, I'm just a little impaired. I know right now you don't care, but soon enough you're gonna think of me. I'm not crazy, I'm just a little unwell.
you don't care, but soon enough you're gonna think of me and how I used to be.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox. My child is Indigenous and looks female. And even though they are a young adult, they are short and small and appear to be about 13 years old. They have a disability, which means they can easily get lost. That's exactly what happened a few nights ago. They found themselves in an industrial area at about 11:30 at night with no idea how to get home. It was dark and isolated with no businesses open. They tried to call me, but their phone was dead. So they approached the only option that seemed available to them, a gas terminal that's not open to the public, but which appeared to have some lights on inside the building. They used the buzzer inside the small lobby, but no one answered. A semi-truck had gone into the yard, a gate locked behind it, and a while later, when the semi was leaving, my child, lost in this desolate area, asked the truck driver for help. Specifically, they asked to use his phone to be able to call me so they could get home. His response was to wave them off and refuse to help. When my child didn't arrive as expected, I went out hoping to find them. Having tried all the usual routes, I went down a road further away. I found my child sitting on the side of the road. This industrial area has little to no foot traffic, so there are no sidewalks. They were literally sitting on the side of the road, curled up in a fetal position, sobbing and clearly in distress. When I pulled up, they quickly got in my car and then expressed confusion and trauma at the fact that the driver of the semi-truck that was now waiting for the gate behind him to close and lock had refused to help them. I pulled my car in front of the semi to block him from being able to drive away and approached him. I asked why would he not help this child, and his response was, "You have to understand that the last time I let somebody..." And you know what I did with his response, right? I stopped him. I told him it didn't matter. It didn't need to give the phone to the child. Just call someone to help them. Clearly, this driver was prepared to drive away and leave this child alone, curled up on the side of the road in the dark in this isolated area. I want to remind everybody that children are our responsibility. They are everybody's responsibility. They are not just mine or yours. Every child on this planet deserves to be kept safe from harm, and every adult on this planet, whether it is your child or not, has a responsibility to do what they can to make that happen. Every time we see a child or any vulnerable person who is in distress, we have a responsibility to do something to protect them. Truck drivers and others who drive for a living, in my opinion, have a greater responsibility, and it may not be a legal one, but it is certainly a moral one and an ethical one, to report, intervene, and provide support to those in trouble, especially children. Children who were lost and recovered most often talk about approaching someone for help. Be that person, that when you're approached, you give that help and make sure that kid gets safe. This could have easily become a tragic situation for my child. While stats differ by who is counting, there are thousands of murdered and missing Indigenous women in Canada. We can reduce that number by just staying alert and reaching out for help. All that needs to happen is to intervene, support, and protect. In my child's case, it would have taken all of 5 minutes to help. So I'm hoping that we all will do that. Let's do better than that truck driver did 2 nights ago.
Well, we've been the hip couple at school for over 3 months now. And boy, are we happy. Why, we dress alike, and we almost talk alike, and we do everything together. and I wish we could stay this age forever.
Hey, have you heard about Rock Talk? This particular program might change your musical taste and influence the way you dress. And you could even become the hip couple at school, co-op radio style. Rock Talk, Friday mornings at 9 o'clock.
Well, wear what you might call the criteria of hipness, you know? Well, it's after 6, so I think I'll call her. We're going to the movies tonight. I think we'll wear our matching desert boots.
You're listening to Both Sides Now on Vancouver Call Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. I'm Bernadine Fox, and that's our show. We were entertained by Matchbox 20, Elton John, Linkin Park, and Sherry Ulrich. Our thanks to Teresa Morton from My Artist Corner and Penny Goldsmith from Highs and Lows Choir for coming and chatting with us about art and mental health, but also my thanks to Don Wright for co-hosting and to Stephen in the sound booth. But most importantly, our thanks goes out to you for joining us today. If you have questions or feedback about this program or want to share your story or have something to say to us, we want to hear from you. You can reach us by email, bothsidesnow@coopradio.org, or via Twitter, @bothsidesnowbc. This is Bernadine Fox. We'll be back next week. Until then.